Have you ever wondered how your phone goes from empty to full in 20 minutes? Fast charging technology is now being applied in many devices which have lithium-ion batteries, from phones and laptops to electric vehicles and beyond. However, what are the downsides of charging your device too fast, and should you be worried about it? I'm Dr. Billy Wu, and in this video we'll be exploring how fast charging your batteries works, why it's not all good if you go too fast, and what we can do to improve it. Firstly, what do we mean by battery fast charging? In short, this is where we deliver higher power to reduce the charging time. To unpack this, we first have to understand some of the key metrics. The capacity of our battery, measured in ampere hours, represents the amount of electrical charge it can store. The nominal voltage is the average voltage of the battery over its operating range, and the energy is the product of the two given in watt hours. If we then want to estimate the charging time for that given battery, we divide the energy in watt hours by the power in watts to get the theoretical charging time in hours. Here we see that the charging time depends on both the characteristics of the charger and the battery. For an example electric vehicle, this might use parallel cell strings where the capacity adds up to about 150 ampere hours. Here, the nominal pack voltage might be around 400 volts, giving a 60 kilowatt hour battery pack. If using a standard charger with a power of 1.5 kilowatts, this would take approximately 40 hours to fully charge. If using a fast charger at 100 kilowatts, this would take around 36 minutes. Note that all of these times assume there are no limitations, and often in reality, the charging time is longer due to limitations which we'll discuss later. Looking specifically at the example of a Porsche Taycan, one of the fastest charging electric vehicles, we can see it has a 97 kilowatt hour battery pack, 800 volt architecture, and maximum charging power of 320 kilowatts with a stated range of between 372 and 510 miles. From Porsche's website, we can see that using a 9.6 kilowatt AC charger would take 13 hours to charge from 0 to 100% state of charge, whereas if maximum power DC charging was used, this would take only 18 minutes from 10 to 80%. Now, in the Porsche example, you may have noticed reference to AC and DC charging, but what do these mean? If we first look at AC charging, this takes alternating current from the grid and then uses the vehicle's onboard charger to convert this to direct current for the battery pack. This is usually slower at speeds up to around 22 kilowatts, resulting in charging speeds of around 30 miles per hour of charge. You would normally find these types of chargers at home, a workplace, or long duration parking areas like supermarkets. For DC charging, which is usually much faster, it uses DC power from an external power source, bypassing the vehicle's onboard charger to directly charge the battery. Power can reach up to 350 kilowatts, although higher power systems have been trialed. This can give up to 800 miles of range per hour of charge. You'll generally find these systems at fast charging stations. If we now look inside the battery, we can see a cylindrical cell has a structure similar to a Swiss roll. Here, we have multiple layers which make a unit cell. Firstly, we have a layer of copper which provides an electrical pathway. Then, we have a porous anode, typically made of graphite, and a porous polymer separator which prevents the anode and cathode from touching. We then have a porous cathode, usually made of a transition metal oxide, which is connected to an aluminium cathode current collector, and finally a liquid electrolyte fills the void space. When the battery is fully discharged, all the lithium ions are in the cathode. When we charge the battery, the lithium ions move from the cathode to the anode via the electrolyte. The electrons can't go through the separator or electrolyte, and therefore have to pass through an external circuit where they recombine with the lithium ions at the anode. This reaction reverses when we discharge the battery. So that's the basic view of how batteries work, but what actually limits the real charging speed? In the first instance, there's the maximum power of the charger you're using, as previously discussed. Then there's voltage limits, which shouldn't be exceeded, which we'll look at in a moment. Similarly, there are also temperature limits. And finally, we also want to avoid an effect called lithium plating. Combined, these effects mean the actual charging speed is often lower than the theoretical speed. So earlier we saw that the actual charging speed of a battery is often lower than its theoretical value. One of the reasons for this is that we need to keep a battery within its upper and lower voltage limits to avoid damaging the cell. This is often 2.7 volts to 4.2 volts, but depends on the chemistry. When charging, if we go over 4.2 volts, this can cause side reactions such as the decomposition of the electrolyte, which can cause the generation of flammable gases and accelerated degradation of the cell. Therefore, one of the most common charging protocols is the constant current constant voltage profile, or CCCV. In this 0.5C example, the theoretical time to full charge is 2 hours. However, in reality, it takes 2.8 hours. This is because as we apply the constant current to the battery, the voltage increases, but when it hits 4.2 volts, we have to decrease the current to avoid pushing the voltage too high. Thus, we have two parts of the charging protocol, a faster constant current portion and a slower constant voltage portion where the current is decreased to avoid side reactions such as decomposition of the liquid electrolyte. If we want to increase the speed of charging, the most common approach is simply to increase the current. Here, the term C rate is a measure of the rate at which the battery is charged or discharged relative to its maximum capacity. We calculate this as the ratio of the applied current to the capacity, with the inverse of this giving the charging time in hours. Returning to our 0.5C example, which is 2.5 amps for our 5 ampere hour cell, we see that the theoretical charging time is 2 hours and the actual time to 100% is 2.8 hours. Now, because our charging speed drops significantly towards the end of charge, the time to 80% stay of charge is often quoted instead. When we increase the C rate to 1C, the theoretical charge time to 100% is 1 hour, but in reality, the full charge time only drops to 2.1 hours, or 0.8 hours to 80%. As we increase the C rate further to 2C, which should give a 30-minute charge time, the actual charging time only drops to 1.8 hours or 30 minutes to 80%. This diminishing return when increasing the current is due to hitting the 4.2 volt limit, after which the charging current is reduced. Beyond voltage limits, we also have temperature limits, which is particularly important if thermal runaway and fire is to be avoided. If we return to our schematic of a battery, one important detail is something called the solid electrolyte interface, or SEI. When we have lithiated graphite, this is unstable with most battery electrolytes and starts reacting. Luckily, whilst there are some initial reactions between the lithiated graphite and the electrolyte, this then semi-passivates the surface to protect it from further reactions. However, if the temperature of the battery goes over 70 degrees, this SEI starts to decompose. As the heat continues to accumulate, the electrolyte reacts with the lithiated graphite, which is an exothermic process. If the temperature goes over approximately 130 degrees C, the polymer separator then melts, causing a short circuit between the anode and the cathode, which releases further heat. At approximately 200 degrees C, the liquid electrolyte then starts to decompose, releasing toxic chemicals such as hydrofluoric acid. Then, at about 300 degrees C, the cathode then decomposes, leading to oxygen release, which can make extinguishing a fire extremely difficult. We therefore want to avoid thermal runaway at all costs, and if you're interested in this, I have a separate video linked in the comments and above, which focuses on battery safety. Returning to the battery behavior during charging, as we add more current to the battery, naturally the cell will heat up faster, and thus we need to be able to monitor this. Here, you can see that as we increase the C rate from C over 2 to 3C, the maximum current obviously increases, with the temperature profile also increasing. As we get to the 3C charging rate, we can see that we approach a dangerous temperature which, if not managed, can result in thermal runaway. Of course, this temperature can be managed to a certain degree with the use of a thermal management system which removes heat from the battery, but there are limits to how effective this can be. Finally, if the cell voltage and temperature aren't limiting factors, the other main barrier to fast charging is lithium plating. In the ideal charging process, lithium ions from the cathode are intercalated into the anode. However, if this is done too quickly, instead of intercalating the lithium ions, form metallic lithium on the surface of graphite. This is bad for a number of reasons. Firstly, this metallic lithium is highly reactive to the electrolyte, and secondly, it can form dendrites or needles of lithium, which can short-circuit the battery and lead to failure. In this great video from Zhukun Liu et al., we see a graphite electrode being lithiated. This starts from the left-hand side, where we have the separator, and as graphite lithiates, the color changes from gray to golden. As this continues, we get to a point where metallic lithium forms, and if this pierces the separator, this can cause a short circuit or at the very least form additional SCI, resulting in degradation. To understand when lithium plating occurs, we first need to revisit the voltage you measure on a battery. Here, you can see the typical voltage of a single lithium-ion battery from 0% state of charge to 100. This voltage is made up of two components, the anode of our battery, which is typically graphite, and the cathode, which is often a transition metal oxide. Here, the overall cell voltage is the difference between the cathode and the anode potentials. When the battery is at 0% state of charge, the lithium ions are mostly in the cathode, with the cathode potential at its lowest and the anode potential at its highest, giving a low overall voltage. When the battery is charged, the lithium ions move to the anode, and when doing this causes the cathode potential to increase and the anode potential to decrease, giving a higher overall cell voltage. This forms the basis of our understanding, but these voltages and potentials are shown for extremely low C rates, which for this case is C over 100, or what we will call our pseudo-open circuit potentials. Now, if we focus on the anode, which is where we have the lithium ions moving towards, we can see what happens when we start increasing the current from our slow C over 100 charge. At C over 2, or a 2-hour theoretical charge, we can see that as we increase current, the anode potential drops for the same state of charge due to resistances in the cell. Increasing this further to 1C further decreases the dynamic anode potential. However, you can see once we apply a 2C load at approximately 20% state of charge, the anode potential goes below 0 volts versus lithium, which is the region where lithium plating can thermodynamically occur. The further negative we are, the faster the rate of lithium plating occurs as opposed to the ideal lithium ion intercalation into graphite. Thus, the key to avoiding lithium plating and therefore long lifetime is to avoid the anode potential going negative. Now that we understand that lithium plating occurs when the anode potential goes negative, we can revisit ways to improve the charging speed. If we look at a typical 1C CCCV charging profile, we can see from the anode potential at a low state of charge or start of charging period that we are not close to the plating region, meaning that we could potentially apply a bit more current in this period without risking lithium plating. This is where the idea of a charging profile called boost charging comes in, whereby we apply a higher current at the beginning of charge, but then reduce this before the anode potential goes negative. By doing this, we put more charge into the battery when we were further away from the lithium plating region. In this example, we go from taking 50 minutes to charge 80% for the CCCV profile to 45 minutes with the boost charging profile, which is a 10% reduction in charge time without additional lithium plating, in theory. Now, this is just one simple example, but other variations exist with greater benefits which have been optimized for a specific battery. However, it should also be noted that the anode potential can also be influenced by factors such as temperature, where generally lower temperature charging runs a higher risk of lithium plating. Beyond CCCV and boost charging, there are also a number of other charging profiles which people are currently investigating. These include pulse charging, where we pulse the charging current as opposed to having a constant current load. Here, results have suggested that this can reduce battery impedance and reduce the effects of some of the degradation mechanisms. Beyond that, another approach is anode potential control, whereby we use a model to estimate the anode potential of a cell when charging, and then use this model to maximize the charging current whilst avoiding the lithium plating regime. The challenge here is having a model which can estimate the anode potential accurately. And of course, there are many other profiles which people are currently researching, but we have not covered in this video. So, to summarize, fast charging lithium-ion batteries is where we deliver higher power to reduce charging time. Commercially, for electric vehicles, we have AC charging, which is generally slower and can take over 24 hours to fully charge a vehicle, but this depends on the exact charger and the size of the battery. Faster DC charging is now being rolled out, which bypasses an electric vehicle's onboard charger to apply hundreds of kilowatts of power, which can charge a battery in less than 20 minutes. However, in reality, we have a number of factors which limit the speed of charging, which includes keeping the voltage of the battery within safe limits. This is often 4.2 volts maximum in many high energy dense batteries, which is imposed to avoid side reactions such as electrolyte decomposition, which can accelerate degradation and even cause catastrophic failure. Beyond that, we also need to keep the temperature of the battery within safe operating regions, which is typically no higher than around 70 degrees C. If you exceed this, then the protective solid electrolyte interface layer can decompose, leading to thermal runaway. Finally, if we go too fast, then instead of intercalating the lithium ions into the graphite, this can instead play on the surface of the graphite, which leads to accelerated degradation, but also potential formation of dendrites, which can pierce the battery separator and cause a short circuit, again potentially causing catastrophic failure. With this understanding, many are now developing smarter fast charging algorithms, such as the boost charging example, where we put extra current into the battery at the beginning of charging when we are at a lower risk of lithium plating, or other methods such as push charging and anode potential control, which have also been shown to have benefits. So thank you for listening, and I hope you found this video interesting and helpful. I have a number of other videos on batteries, and if interested in learning more, do have a look at these, which are on my channel and personal website.